killed. Andhakara is darkness. Once again, darkness is ignorance. That's our ego. That is also a huge asura that's inside all of us. We pray to Shiva and that is also wiped out. Coming back to the supreme temple, we meet with a Dwarapalaka at the entrance. We can just see him and we can run inside. And if we do, we'll miss the symbolism. So this is the foot of the Dwarapalaka, under which is a python with its mouth open, with an elephant inside the mouth over there. So you and I know the size of an elephant. And we know, we can understand what the size of a python with its mouth open swallowing the elephant will be. And then here is the foot of the Dwarapalaka in scale. So this is the elephant and this is the foot of the Dwarapalaka. And then this is the entire Dwarapalaka. And he is pointing with what is called Vismaya Hasta, complete astonishment at the God within. And he says, look at what a big Ishvara, Brihad Ishvara is there. We've missed that completely. And we go to Gangaikonda Cholapuram. On one side, again, we have two huge Dwarapalakas. They have the same symbolism as was there in the earlier temple. I'll conclude in a few minutes by showing you some things that we feel very bad about. We go to, many of you here may have seen this presentation. It'll be a repeat, I'm sorry. So this is the Badami Cave 3 in Badami. We have an amazing Stanaka Narasimha over here. He's standing here. He's leaning to one side, but we don't understand why he's leaning till we see an old photograph when we see him leaning on the gada that is here. I'll go back to this. There is no gada. It's gone. So we don't understand why he's leaning to one side. Now that's gone. We go to Mamallapuram, and here you have the people of the past sometimes dated, sometimes didn't date, but this graffiti is clearly dated. And how much can we guard our treasures? We are the people who must learn to safeguard it. That's all gone. This is how we trash something that is so very important in a UNESCO World Heritage Site. This Mukteshwara temple, which I just showed you earlier, 8th century, there are some sculptures belonging to a slightly later date, but did we have to do this to an amazing Nataraja? We go to Mamallapuram, to the Sthalashayana Perumal temple, which is one of the 108 Divya Deshams. This is how it looked, our Mamallapuram, once upon a time. There is a four-pillared mantapa that is now used as an auto stand, and it may have looked like this in the past. And here you have trashed this place and you have spat upon it and you have raised the road level to cover the foot of this feet of this Vishnu. He's here up to his thigh and the Garuda is up to like this. And this is a Vaishnava Acharya and Narasimha, we've done this to Narasimha. And yeah, so I come to Chennai. This is a temple in Mylapore. Now this entire old structure is missing now, as also a 12th century inscription that was at its base. Temple tanks are like this. We've trashed them, not understanding that they are water harvesting bodies. We think these ancient sculptures are only meant for our extra vibhuti and kumkumam. That's not the reason they were meant for. And a temple tank was a water harvesting unit where in times of copious rain, a lot of water would fill it and in the dry summer months could be used. But we have trashed that also. And the paintings in the Varadaraja Swami temple, I took these a long time back. They are in a much, much better condition now. But should we do this to paintings that are at least 400, 450 years old and scribbling our own names at the base over there when the original painters didn't leave their autographs behind? This is the state of Lakshmi. And I end with a few slides. The Murundishwara temple of Nandi and the use to which he has been put by present day people. The Uttandishwara temple in Thirumalishai, which is very close to Chennai, has a wonderful Chola period Gajaprishta Vimanam. This is a technical term. And these are ancient Chola inscriptions, but we have used this space to hang up a clock. We know of Hampi, which was the ancient capital of Vijayanagar. and this was the vast jurisdiction of the Vijayanagara emperors. This was their seal. You all know it well. The Varaha was there. In front of it was the sword, a symbol of authority, and the Surya and Chandra symbols as well. The Vijayanagara rulers' symbolism was that, and this was their royal crest, their emblem, that like Varaha, who retrieved Bhuma Devi from the clutches of this terrible demon Hiranyaksha, we, like the Varaha Avatara too, will save India from many an invasion, many a destructive invasion. They would do that with the help of their arms, and they would do that as long as Surya and Chandra were there. So this is the kind of legacy that we come from. This is the kind of legacy that is left behind in our temples. I have shown you what was. I have also given you an indication of what is. We have completely lost it. When we go into a temple, we go with just one intention, and that is to pray, and that should be the principal intention. I am not for a moment taking away from the bhakti factor, but if we look around a temple, and the Taittiri Upanishad clearly says, antar bahischa yat sarvam vyapta narayana sthitaha, inside and out, everything is Narayana. So if you want to see God inside the Garbhagraha, yes, he is there. Isn't he there outside also? So many little hints have been left for us on how to look at a temple and how to behave inside a temple. I'm afraid we haven't picked up anything from any of their clues. And if the Vijayanagara emperors fought so hard to protect what was there in the Pallava, Chola, Pandya, Hoysala, Kakatiya, and Chera, what all those dynasties have left behind were safeguarded by the Vijayanagara and added to also, don't you think it's our duty to do a rethink on how we should visit a temple and to change our spots completely? I rest my case. Thank you very much.
Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Today we just heard from Ms. Chithra Madhavan what temples were in the past. So the question arises in our minds about what temples should be in the future, because as you know, the state of temples. So we do have two panelists here, very eminent people, and a moderator as well. And we hope we'll have time enough to answer your questions as well. Chithra Madhavan, of course, needs no introduction to you people at all. She is a research scholar and she focuses on temple architecture, iconography and epigraphy. She is a recipient of two postdoctoral fellowships from the Department of Culture, Government of India, and from the Indian Council of Historical Research, New Delhi. She frequently delivers lectures on heritage-related topics in various places in India. I think we really enjoyed the talk given by
Chithra. Thank you so much.
So we have here two panelists today to talk about the future of temples. She's T. Satyamurthy. He's a Sanskrit-Samskritam scholar and a veteran archaeologist. He's the present director of Academy of Archaeology and Sciences of Ancient India. He's also a member of Conservation Committee appointed by Honorable High Court of Madras. And he's Honorary Secretary, Dr. U. Vesa Library, Chennai, and Member Heritage Conservation Committee, CMDA. He's also a member of Appeals Committee, Export of Non-Antiquates, Archaeological Survey of India, Chennai, which is, as you know, is a topic of interest to many of us. We have another panelist, very eminent person, Sri N. Gopalaswami. He's a former Chief Election Commissioner of India, as you all know. And he's a present chairman of Kalakshetra and a champion of Sanskritam language. He is president of Vekananda Educational Society, which runs 22 schools in and around Chennai. Sri N. Gopalaswami was instrumental in moving the UNESCO to confer the World Heritage status to two Chola period temples in Tamil Nadu, Dharasuram and Gangaikonda Cholapuram, which both of which we saw today. It was his initiative that led to the incorporation of Vedic chanting as oral heritage of the world by the UNESCO. We're all seeing all kinds of messages on the phone and whatever social media about people reciting Vedic chanting outside India, not inside India. He was awarded the highest civilian award, high civilian award, the Padma Bhushan in 2015. So as a moderator to today's panel discussion, we have Ms. Vijayalakshmy Subramaniam. She's an eminent classical musician. You all know her as well. She taught the subject An Introduction to Indian Music at the Duke University, North Carolina, USA, as a visiting Fulbright Fellow in 2010. She's also presented papers at international conferences in many countries over the last decade. May I request all three of you to please come and talk by yourself. Request T.R. Ramachandran to please come and give them our token of appreciation and affection to the panelists and Chithra, of course, and also the moderator. Thanks. Thank you. I'll leave the stage to the moderator who will start the proceedings. Thank you.
Very good evening to everyone here. And we are already into the mood and into the temples and the glorious past and tradition that we are also proud of, thanks to my good friend Chitra's lecture here. And delighted to share the stage with such eminent people as Sri Gopalaswami and Dr. Satyamurthy. I think this is a very, very relevant and important subject that we are talking about today. First part of it is very esoteric and intangible, starting with, you know, who or what is God. And this is something that generations of people have accepted unquestioningly, and the faith that we have over time. And what is this dimension, and how is it that we try to understand this and incorporate it into our lives to try and make better people of ourselves? So we find people who are, you know, spiritually evolved, finding divinity. We say divinity is everywhere. And you find people who are very evolved, you know, finding that in a flower, in the touch of a breeze, in the song of a bird. The little less involved perhaps need a sunset or a sunrise to realize that there is something beyond. And the least evolved perhaps need to see spectacles such as the Mount Everest or the Niagara Falls or the Pacific Ocean. And the rest, I think, need God to perform miracles. So what is this dimension that we are trying to understand and appreciate and gain from? Why do we need temples? What are temples? We saw today the wealth of information, the wealth of services beyond bhakti that the temples provided. So what is it about temples that draws people to them? Is it just the house of God, a devalayam? Or what is it that we are looking for in a temple? We find some places of worship which have become big kshetras. You find a Tirupati or Madurai, Chidambaram, which draws hordes of devotees. And today we have the convenience of travel, we have the convenience of, you know, media, and we can see and listen to so much. But there was a time when you only had to walk. And at best, if you were fortunate, you had a bullock cart. Think of the times of people like Adi Shankara and the kind of legacy that they have left for us, not only in terms of the hymns, but the Agama Shastras, the temples. So what is it about these temples? We find very often that they have built there because of the vision of a seer, because of a miraculous feat that happened, or sometimes the idol is a Swayambhu. But there is something beyond this, some energy in the temples which draws everyone there. And we know, we heard about the Shivagama or the Vaikhanasa. So I would like to start the discussion by requesting Dr. Satyamurthy to tell us, why do we need temples, and what is it that has gone into the construction of these temples, which does it harness the energy? How does it increase our bhakti, our spirituality? What is it about the temples?
Thank you. Namaskar to all. Of course, temple, the necessity of the temple to the society, of course it is a subject which all we know and also we discuss. But the problem is how these temples came into existence. What was the purpose, as he wanted to know? You know, suddenly there is the great energy which we were having throughout the universe. that is was put into a small sculpture. You know, you go to the temple, not to see the temple outside only, you go to a particular sculpture and see what we call sculpture. It is an idol. Of course, generally people think that is also the others say, that is the Hindus or even the India, they worship idols. We don't worship idols. We worship only image. We believe that is the entire energy is in that particular, that is a figure. So when you go to the temple, that is, you are not going only all around, but you want to see the main figure, because our ancient Indians have a great art, that is by which this the sthapatya is a science, by which this the energy which is all pervasive cosmic energy was brought to this small place, from macrocosm to microcosm. So the skill of them, the architectural skill of them, that is how it the energy can be brought to this small sculpture, was the great science which our people that is developed in centuries together. It was not only a sudden day it has come into existence. It came after many experiments. That is, if you go to the agamas or sastras, which are all prescribed, they all experimented and put it. They're all manuals. Don't think these sastras are simply written. Simply is that is on somebody's fancy. They're all experiments. For instance, I will tell you only one experiment. The subject can be discussed in detail somewhere. But for instance, you know, that is the agamas, particularly the many agamas that is suggest. If you want to select a stone for a temple, that is, which can be a permanent one, that is, you have to go for a quarry, that is, which is having the rock, that is, having the topmost portions on southern side, and which is sloping towards the north. This such kind of rock, if you select, it will be either sturdy, it will be permanent. That it says almost so many agamas prescribe this. So we did an experiment on this particular issue because we don't know what were the actual queries. But we know them, that is, there are temples that is which are having, that is, rocket temples throughout India, thousands of rocket temples. If you take all these rocket temples and survey it and document it and see it, almost all this, even if you go to Mahamallapuram, you can see that is the Pancharathas. That is the topmost portion will be what your hand, southernmost part is this Dharmaraja Ratha, and lower part will be this is the Dharupadi Ratha, sloping towards the south to north. So this is there for 1,300 years without being affected. Even we don't have a salt action in this particular rocket temple. So throughout India, there is even Buddhist case, throughout India, this research was done. And more than 88% of the rocket temples were constructed only on such rocks. So this was an experiment made by them. And then it was recorded in the Agama Sastras, in the Silpa text. So Silpa texts are not mere there is text, but they are all the that is experiments which they have done. So our great that is architects, the ancient India, of course, if you take the Sthapadi, don't consider the Sthapadi of the modern days. Ancient Sthapadis were having so much of knowledge. If you see the first chapter itself tells how a Sthapadi should be. He should know the essence of four Vedas. So many sciences he must know, that is geology, geography, so many things he must know to construct a temple. So he put all these things into his mind and designed the temple to get this energy which is in macrocosm to bring it to the small sculptures. So from that we started worshipping, and that we are energy, even now we are getting, there is a reason we are going there to get the energy only. We get recharged by seeing all these things that inside the temple.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to ask Sri Gopalaswami now. So what do you think is the relationship between God and the individual? And how does a temple allow for the spiritual. As a corollary, I would like to ask that, you know, a temple is a public space where everybody comes and worships. But in our tradition, we have the liberty and this wonderful ability to have an Ishta Devata, where you can at home do all the upajarams, you can do the prasadam, the nevedyam and everything, which you may not be able to participate to that extent in a public temple. So what is it about the temple that is necessary for an individual growth?
Namaskaram. Priya question. அதுக்கு ஆன்சர் நான் இன்னும் தேடணும். பட் let me say a few things about see the idea of you or an individual as a speck in the universe is something which is right from the beginning of our concept of Godhead or whatever beyond us. Has been there, whether it's in the Vedas or elsewhere. That tradition, that understanding was there all through. But when it came to manifestation, later on, I mean, how do you make it available to many people? I mean, each one is very simple to say. It's written there, Aham Brahmasmi. How do you realize that? It's there, written there, Aham Brahmasmi. Just by chanting Aham Brahmasmi, do you understand that? Or will you reach that? That's not going to be possible. So nobody is going to take an MA in history unless he passes the 10th, 12th. Some brilliant people may be there, but generally everybody has to have some steps through which you climb. So temple became one of the focal points for you to understand. But then I suppose the concept of what a temple should ultimately be to a person. Chitra very wonderfully brought out various facets of the temple, I mean, including whether the sculpture or the music or the sthalavriksham. I personally feel, and sometimes, you know, some of the very subtle messages, they remain subtle. We have not understood them very well. And, we are, now the more we have gone away, the less we are capable of understanding and explaining. And Chitra very rightly said, why erotic sculptures? We all feel very shy about it, very uncomfortable about it. Same way, if somebody tells you that, what is the vahana of Ganapati? Many persons will tell you it is rat. I am quite sure those in the southern part of the country will understand it very clearly that it is not rat, it's a mouse, mushika. How many of us know a mushika is a non-vegetarian? Do you know that? It eats many insects. Well, a rat will eat what you eat. So it's your competitor. Mushika is not. Mushika will clean up the house. Therefore, the subtle message was given that inside the house, if there is a mouse, don't kill it. Adhukku oru perum solluva. Lakshmi vandiruka adhanaala kodaladhinga. At least, enga veetla namala solluva. Adhu enna lakshmi endru theriyum. Purinjathaan adhu yaravadhu solli kudutha theriyum. It is precisely because that subtle message that it's a helper. Please don't harm the helper. So it keeps your house clean. It helps you to ensure that the insect population is kept under control. Every little part. For instance, we have Naga Devati Pooja Pandram. Garudana Pooja Pandram. Why? See, in a predominantly agriculture country, in agricultural field, what is your first enemy? This rat. Who controls the rat? The serpent. Who controls the serpent? The other, especially the Garuda or what. So the cycle was very well understood. And I take you back to the 70s, where in China, they all felt that the sparrows eat away a lot of food grains. Therefore, a simple solution was found. Kill all the sparrows. And it is possible in a totalitarian country that order is issued and it will be implemented. So all the sparrows are killed. I mean, you were rewarded for killing the sparrows. But what happened thereafter? You lost more grains. Because along with the little bit of grain which it was eating, it was also eating the insects, which was protecting the crop, which was not understood. After 4 or 5 years, when they understood that the sparrows actually do you a service, they said, no, don't anymore kill. Help them to grow. So a temple here was an educational institution. Apart from what is being taught through the education institution, it is also an educational venture for you to understand your position in the universe, what is there around you which you need to understand and protect and be happy with it. So the temple used to be more than something merely housing a personal god, which you could always. As you grow in your experience, it's very likely that you need less and less external stimulants for you to understand your position or try and reach a sense of your place in the universe and your oneness with the Godhead. So most probably, I mean, these one could think of all the temples as areas where education is imparted, not only physically, but also in a very subtle way. And today, if that is not happening, I mean, this is one of the issues which is not. Why is it not happening? First and foremost, in my view, is the government taking over all the temples. So you and I got separated from the temples. You go to worship and come away. Somebody else is looking after the community used to look after the temple. No longer. You have no connection at all. It's something like, you know, outside you just go there, spend your time and come back. Of course, there are so many other dimensions to this. But basically, that education which was being imparted is no longer required. Or at least we all think that this is no longer required. And therefore, we have moved away. Is there any future? Yes, I suppose there is some future. We'll discuss it later on.
Thank you. So that is exactly the point that I was coming to next, as to what is our understanding of education today. And because what we saw from what the temples were teaching is very different from what we perceive as being relevant education today.
Of course, the temples not only preserved simply this Vedic education, it gave opportunity for every community to come and learn, not only learning, also to have their own livelihood. For instance, if you go to a temple, if you want to present one small lamp to the temple, not like today, you go to present 33, at least 33 goats or cows. So that is known as mupuli, means it will, if the goats are given, it will multiply. So that was not given to the temple, it will be given to the society, to the village. The village men will, preserve it and give only in turn, some ghee to the temple for lighting the lamp. So it was all, it was for the society, not only temple was only for worship, it's not for the society. You may be surprised to know, from the temple, you can take loan of even gold for your daughter's marriage or son's marriage if you want. You can take loan from the temple. That is the temple for everything, the fine was in terms of some gold. The gold will be deposited in the temple treasury. So it can be taken as a loan from the villager. If the villager wants to have something for the temple, he can approach the authorities. They will give it on a loan. It can be returned.
So the temple also worked as a bank.
Yeah, you are right. You are more. It worked as a lab. So interestingly, it's not like the modern days where you can simply go and while you return, you have to return with the interest. While you return the gold, that is, you may see that a person who is testing it has to give account for the gold which has even rubbed, that is to see the purity of it. That should be again deposited to the temple. So they were so clear that no temple property should be taken out. So don't think if say